Hello, friends and enemies. Today we are going to talk about the HBO comedy show Los Spookies. I know what my regular viewers must be thinking. What? Two non-music episodes in a row? Are you changing the focus of your channel? No, I have a specific schedule I need to work with, and don't you worry, my next few videos are definitely going to be music related, I promise. In any case, this one is kind of music related as well because I literally found out about this show because one of the bands whose music I've talked about here before, Varsovia, has some of their music featured in the show and they were talking about it online, so see? Relevant. Anyways, on to the actual show. It was created by Fred Armisen, Julio Torres, and Ana Fabrega, who all act in the show in leading roles as well. It's pretty unusual in that it's a mostly Spanish language show, but it's on regular old HBO. Yes, non-Spanish speaking friends. There are subtitles, though no dubs, which is fine because after years of internet debate, we should all know by now that subs are better than dubs. The show takes place in an unnamed Latin American country. I looked it up. It's not supposed to be anywhere specific, though fun fact, it is mostly filmed around Santiago, Chile. Most of the actors, according to my research, are Mexican, but not all of them, like co-creators. Julio Torres is Salvadoran. Yay! We're probably related somehow. Seriously, it's a very small country. So what this show is actually about is a group of four friends who decide to start this little horror experience group called Los Spookies. They're mostly led by Reynaldo, not Reynaldo, just Reynaldo. The lack of Y in his name is actually a bit of a plot point. Portrayed by Bernardo Velasco, who is the one who's the most into horror, though all of them are. And at the beginning of the show, the one with the least going for him, he just has his friends and his horror, especially made by Bianca Nova, portrayed by Carol Kane. Great casting choice there. His friends include the blue-haired rich gay boy Andres, portrayed by show co-creator, and my Salvadoran brother, Julio Torres. He is the soon-to-be heir of a chocolate company and conflicted by the disapproval of his parents and his jerky boyfriend, Juan Carlos, portrayed by Jose Pablo Minor, who is the heir to a cookie company and also an Instagram fitness influencer, it appears. Also, Andres has a mysterious backstory. Also in this group is Ursula, portrayed by Cassandra Ciangarotti. I hope I said that right. It's an Italian last name, apparently. Both the best at the technical aspects of their little skits and the most serious-minded, responsible member. Finally, there is Tati, portrayed by show co-creator Ana Fabrega, who is Ursula's little sister and not very bright. Fred Armisen portrays Ronaldo's uncle Tico, who lives in Los Angeles, where he is a valet parker, and he is the best car parker of all time. The titular group, Los Spookies, basically get hired by people who want these scary experiences that people think are real. Well, the person who hired them knows that it's fake, but the people who they're hired to make these experiences for, from an exorcism to an alien encounter, are meant to think it's real. Six episodes of the so far one season show revolve around how Los Spookies get started and how they get going, and the situations around why people who hire them want to subject the people in their lives to whatever horrific experience, as well as personal hijinks of each of the characters, and teach us lessons about friendship and following your dreams. That probably sounds really cheesy, but that's the most I can say without spoiling anything significant, because there are no spoilers here. More important than the storyline, to me anyways, is the general feel of the show. As I mentioned, it is a comedy. The humor relies greatly on absurd situations treated as regular events and exaggerations of real types of people, such as the Barbie-esque US ambassador and the Machiavellian CEO of an all-too-familiar multi-level marketing company. The horror skits done by the group are all fake. It's important to mention that the reality that the show takes place in is not like our own. There are fantastical events involving cursed objects and inner spirits, giving the world a sort of magical realism type vibe. For those of you who are familiar with director Greg Araki, I'm reminded of some of his films, with the banal treatment of absurdity, the fantastical elements in a realistic world, the prominent featured non-heterosexual characters, and there are actually quite a few, and how aesthetic everything is. Seriously, from the first frame on, everything in this show just looks so dang cool. The use of color is not only stunning, but also purposeful, as you will find that certain colors are very intentional motifs. The soundtrack is also quite spectacular. This doesn't speak to the story or anything, but I personally like that we have characters that not only look alternative, but we have actual alternative music featured on the show. Made up of mostly Latin American cold wave acts like Varsovia, Equinoxious, and Hofen. This is the second piece of media I've reviewed featuring a Hofen song, not even counting the Hofen album I reviewed a few weeks ago. Me being wowed by their inclusion on the soundtrack is just my US centrism speaking, and Hofen is considered really basic in other countries. Is Hofen considered basic alternative in Mexico or other parts of Latin America? Is it like, I guess Marilyn Manson and My Chemical Romance are outdated references at this point. Two basic alternative kids in the US listen to these days. I don't know, Billie Eilish? Is Huffin the Latin American Billie Eilish? If so, that makes me even more bitter that I live in the US than I already do. No offense to my followers who like Billie Eilish, she's just not my favorite. I'm too old for her music, okay? I'm a rickety 27-year-old. Never mind that my taste in music has barely changed since I was about 12, but that's the excuse I'm going to use. My baby viewers watching thinking, HBO, if I'm watching this show and my parents walk in, will it get really uncomfortable? Well, that depends on your parents for the most part, but no, not in my opinion. This show is rated TV-MA, so it's not meant for little ones, but it is quite tame by HBO standards. There's some profanity, some references to inappropriate things we can't mention on YouTube, but overall, you know, there's no on-screen sex, there's no graphic violence, it isn't part of a cartoonish skit. It's okay. If your parents are uncool with gay characters, then maybe they'd be weird about it, but you don't see anything. It's fine. As I mentioned, season 1 is out. It did get renewed for season 2, but I'm not sure when that's coming out. I hope that filming wasn't impacted by COVID, which I know happened to a few shows, but we'll see. Speaking of COVID, if you're like me and live somewhere where you're going to be semi-quarantined for the next month, watching this show is a great idea. If you live somewhere that actually listened from the start and people can now leave the house, you should still give it a watch because it's only 6 half-hour episodes. Self-promotion time. I have a whole big channel here. If you need something big to distract you, I have a lot of videos. If you need something small to distract you, most of them are shorter than 10 minutes. If you like what you see, you should follow me elsewhere on social media, all linked below.